Welcome back. So now, after finishing two component solid solution systems, we'll start another type of system which is known as eutectic systems. So as I promised in the first lecture that we will study three types of systems here. The first one is your solid solution that we already completed in the previous lecture series, and then what we are left with is eutectic and peritectic systems, and the focus of this lecture is going to be your eutectic systems. What exactly are eutectic systems? So to better understand eutectic systems, we have to contrast them with your solid solution systems. So the example that I gave in case of solid solutions was that if you mix sugar in water, the sugar will completely dissolve in water and it will form a single phase. You will not be able to point out where exactly is sugar. It is present throughout the system and it is difficult to differentiate. Now if you have, let's say again, water beaker here, and instead of putting sugar in it, you try to put some sand, these sand grains. Now what will be the end result? Will it form a single phase or two separate phases? So as you guessed it right, these sand grains, these will form separate phase and they will not dissolve in water, and you can very easily point out where these sand grains are. And you can say these are my sand grains. Another way to easily understand it is using, let's say, combination of colors. So for example, if I have some grains which are of type A. Now previously we were discussing solid and liquid. Now we are going to discuss if you are trying to mix two types of solids. And let's say you have another type of grains B, which I'm going to denote here by white color. So now if you mix them together, you mix these and you can get two types of results. One in which you have a mixture of these black grains and white grains, and the end result is somewhere in the middle, and I'm going to denote that by gray color. So you can have some grains which are mixture of both A and B, and A and B have mixed together with one another. Now, a different kind of result is possible where they do not form a solid solution and they still exist as A and B grains only. So even if you mix them together, you melt them and you then again recrystallize them, they will not form separate, they will not form a solid solution, they will not mix with one another. So these type of behavior. So for example, here these are both A plus B in solid solution. Here you can differentiate. You can say this is A, this is B. In this case, you cannot differentiate between A and B. So this is a eutectic. This type of behavior will result in eutectic when you are talking about igneous systems, and this will be solid solution. So now the two component eutectic system that we will be focusing upon is your diopside and anorthite system. So diopside is your type of pyroxene and anorthite is a type of feldspar which belongs to plagioclase series. Now you are already familiar with how to read these phase diagrams, and as with previous phase diagrams, on x-axis you have composition as weight percent anorthite, and on y-axis you have temperature in degree centigrade, and during this whole process we will keep the pressure fixed. And just like previous cases, we have here will be four regions. On top at higher temperatures you have liquid region in which you have a single phase which is melt, and below 1274 degree Celsius you have two phases. So instead of single phase that you saw in solid solution, here you are going to have two phases, diopside and anorthite, and both of them will exist as pure components. So you have as many number of solid phases as there are number of components. So these two components, diopside and anorthite, they cannot mix with one another. So between the liquid phase and the complete solid phase, you have these two regions, anorthite plus liquid, in which you have a single solid phase anorthite, so there is no diopside, and this anorthite is pure end member component. And on the other side, on the left side, you have diopside plus liquid, where you have only a single solid phase, which is diopside, and it coexists with liquid. So there is no place in this diagram where diopside and anorthite can coexist with one another, except this point at the center, which you call as eutectic point, where you can have both anorthite and diopside coexist. But outside this point, there is no place where both the phases can coexist.
So after this, we will study, just like we did with plagioclase solid solution, what will happen if we try to melt our solid or crystallize our melt. First, let's consider the crystallization behavior.
So let's again start with somewhere in here. We have, so that 70% anorthite component. So you might be wondering, if these end members do not mix with one another, how can we have this 8% anorthite composition that is somewhere in the middle? So let me demonstrate this to you with an example. So here we are not mixing them with one another, but there is still some grains which are going to be of pyroxene and some which are going to be of feldspar, and we can take their weight and just see which one is forming how much proportion. So for example, if let's say these are your feldspar grains, so you have these FP feldspar grains, and let's say these are your pyroxene grains, so only you have two pyroxenes and four feldspar, so total you have six grains. So your weight percent of feldspar is going to be 4/6 × 100, and your weight percent of pyroxene will be 2/6 × 100%. So this is of course assuming that feldspar and pyroxene here have same density and these grains are of equal size, so that we are just counting them, but in reality you'll have to take weight percent. So let's say I have my starting composition as, or bulk composition as, 70% anorthite, and my initial temperature is 1600 degrees Celsius. So at this pressure, at this temperature and composition, so I will have a liquid phase. So within this region, you have phi equals 1, and in this system, components is still equals 2. So degrees of freedom at fixed pressure is equals to C minus phi plus 1 equals 2.
So 2 degrees of freedom means that
I need two intensive variables to define my state. For example, even if I define one of the variables, which is your composition, so X is one of your variables, if I define it as 70%, I can still have temperature which is anywhere between 1500 and this 1600 and this point. So my temperature, even if I know my composition, I do not know what my temperature is. So that is what you mean by 2 degrees of freedom.
So what we will do now is we will start to cool this system. So when we start to cool it down,
temperature will go down until it will hit this liquidus curve at some point. So you're decreasing your temperature, your composition is not changing, so that is why you move vertically down. Now what will happen at this point when it hits this liquidus curve? So at this point, what is happening, what we did in solid solution, that we drew a horizontal line here. So we are going to do the same here, we are going to draw a horizontal line, but we see this horizontal line does not cross the solidus curve as it did in case of solid solution. So what it does here is it intersects this end point here, the vertical line at the end at anorthite. So that is why you are going to get your first solid as your pure anorthite or 100% anorthite. So you'll get 100% anorthite, even though your liquid is only 70% anorthite, but what you are getting is 100% anorthite as your pure component. And now, because you are crystallizing pure anorthite out of a system which is only 70% anorthite, so your remaining melt will move in opposite direction, that is, it will become more diopside rich. So this is what you'll get is liquid. So here you had liquid 1 composition, and now you'll get liquid 2 composition.
So now what will be the reaction here? The reaction when we go from point 1 to point 2. So the reaction will be
liquid 1 is going to give you liquid 2 plus anorthite. So there is no solid phase over here in this case, because you are forming a pure end member component. And to get these type of reactions, what you can do is you can draw a horizontal line here, and you say your liquid 1 lies somewhere here, which is also your bulk composition, and liquid 1, it is surrounded by liquid 2 and anorthite. So liquid 2 and anorthite combined composition has to be equal to liquid 1 composition. So that is sort of like taking an average. It lies somewhere in middle. So this is your equation here, or the reaction that will take place in this case.
So now what I am going to do, now that I know my liquid will move in this direction, but my bulk composition, that is overall composition, is still going to remain same here. The bulk composition, that is average composition of all the solid plus the liquid melt.
Now another thing that we want to find out is proportion of liquid to anorthite. So what is, how much liquid I have? So this liquid over here and this anorthite over here. So as I keep going down, the amount of anorthite will keep on increasing and amount of liquid will keep on decreasing. Because then I move to, let's say, this point. Now this region is becoming larger and larger. So this is your liquid.
So again, going back to the liver principle. So what I have here is, I have my bulk composition here.
And I'm going to denote it by this bulk composition by X, and I have these two points A and B here. So this A is where you have your liquid, and at B you have your anorthite. Now how do we use liver principle? So to get the proportion of liquid by anorthite, get their proportions, what we do is, so for liquid we are going to take this opposite side, which is BX, and for anorthite we are going to take this opposite side, which is AX. This is how you are going to get your liver principle. What will keep on happening as you keep going from top to bottom, as you keep decreasing your temperature, your AX keeps on becoming larger and larger. So AX keeps on becoming larger as you keep going down, and hence your liquid proportion
keeps on decreasing, and this will continue to keep going until you reach this point,
which is known as your eutectic point. Now, very interesting thing happens here. So as we already saw that in this case, in this zone where you have only liquid, you have 2 degrees of freedom. So before going to eutectic point, let's figure out how many degrees of freedom you have in this anorthite plus liquid zone. So what we are going to do is F equals, now components is 2. Now you have 2 phases, anorthite and liquid. So 2 plus 1, because you are at fixed pressure, so your degrees of freedom in this zone is, in this whole zone is 1. So what do you mean by 1 degrees of freedom? Again, 1 degrees of freedom that says that only one of the intensive variables, one of the 2 intensive variables that we are considering here, that is weight percent anorthite, that is your composition and temperature. So out of these 2 intensive variables, composition and temperature, only one is independent. So it makes sense also. For example, if you know that your temperature is 500 degree to 1500 degree centigrade and you have both anorthite and liquid, so you have to have this composition definitely. So your composition is fixed. You can't have any composition if these compositions are not possible. For example, this composition is not possible, this is not possible. So if you have two phases, liquid and anorthite, you have to have a fixed composition for a given temperature.
Now we are going to go again what we were discussing about this point here called the eutectic point. So if you keep decreasing the temperature, and as we discussed already, at this point you have
phi equals 3 at this point. So what are your three phases? You have diopside, you have anorthite, and you have liquid. So diopside, anorthite, and liquid. So three phases. So what will happen to your degrees of freedom? F equals C is again 2 minus phi is 3 plus 1 because of fixed pressure becomes 0. So at this point you have 0 degrees of freedom. So what do you mean by 0 degrees of freedom? It means there is no, so out of the two variables you are considering, temperature and composition, there is no intensive variable. So there is no intensive variable, or the minimum number of components, minimum number of intensive variables required to define the system is 0. So nobody needs to tell you what is the temperature here or what is the composition of the system. If someone tells you the information that you have three phases, you have diopside, you have anorthite, and you have a liquid, so you will automatically figure out for a fixed pressure that your temperature has to be 1274 degrees Celsius and your composition will be somewhere around 43%. So nobody needs to tell you this information. So at this point here, where degrees of freedom equals 0, is known as the eutectic point. And that is why this whole system is known as the eutectic system. Now what will happen once you are at eutectic point? So you are at this eutectic point. So at this eutectic point, you start getting your first diopside. So what was happening previous to this? I'm going to write it here. So previously, before eutectic, initially you had your melt. So within this melt, after hitting eutectic, after hitting the liquidus, I'm going to draw this diagram here again. So this is your liquidus. So this is your stage one, which is the melt, and then after you hit this liquidus, this is the second stage. So you start getting your anorthite crystals in this case. So plagioclase crystal. So as you keep on moving down, your plagioclase crystals keep becoming more and more abundant.
So let's say you go to some other point, which is your point number 3. So what will happen at this point? So more and more anorthite crystals will solidify, and you are consuming the melt in the process. And now the eutectic point, I'm going to denote this point as point 4. So what will happen at point 4?
You start crystallizing along with these anorthite crystals. You start to crystallize diopside. So I'm going to do it with open circle. So now your diopside also starts forming. So when you started this reaction in here, when you first started crystallizing from the melt, you had only anorthite, 100% anorthite crystals. So the solid, let's say you have a magma chamber in which the solid is forming its pure anorthite. Now
after you hit the eutectic point,
you're also crystallizing diopside.
So what is happening here is that Initially, this is the bulk composition, which should always remain constant throughout the cooling process.
And this is your melt. So it lies somewhere between melt and solid composition. But when you hit at this eutectic point, the new solids that you are crystallizing, they have this fixed composition, which is 40% anorthite in this case, the example that we are considering. So now, because you are increasing, because you are crystallizing more diopside, so the solid composition, so the solid that you have in your system, so here it was again 100%, 100%. Now, if you look at this case over here,
it starts to increase in diopside phase, and these new diopside and anorthite crystals are forming in the proportion determined by eutectic composition.
So until what time this process will go on? So again, try to remember what was happening when you had only one component, which is water, where you were not able to increase the temperature until you lost one of the phases. So the same thing is going to happen here. So once you lose one of the phases, so considering this for us, C minus 5 plus 1. So what is happening at this phase? 2 minus 3 plus 1. You have 3 phases. So you will lose one of the phase. And which is that phase? Because you are crystallizing, so the and you are trying, you are taking heat away from the system. So the phase that will first disappear is melt. So during the cooling stage, it will be the melt. So initially it was zero. So once melt disappears, so in the initial case, your number of phases is liquid plus diopside plus anorthite. So once melt disappears, your phi will only be diopside plus anorthite. So only two phases. So in this case, your degrees of freedom will be 2 minus 2 plus 1, which is again equal to zero. So you have two phases. So what will happen when one of these phases goes away? So when what we are seeing here is it keeps on. So your composition of solids now is becoming more diopside rich because you are crystallizing more diopside than anorthite. So at that point, when one of the phases finishes, which is liquid here, so liquid is finished. So at this point, this overall composition of solids will reach this point, which is again equal to your bulk composition that you initially started with. And now, because you will gain, so I'm showing these arrows here, but this is actually happening over here. So you'll get this composition, which is equal to your bulk composition. And now, because you have lost one of the phases, you have gained 1 degree of freedom. Your temperature or composition can change here because you're not removing anything from the system. Composition will not change, and temperature now you can decrease. It can fall below that eutectic temperature, and you can cool it to whatever temperature you want. So now this behavior that you studied is or falls under equilibrium crystallization of this plagioclase and pyroxene system, in which plagioclase is anorthite and pyroxene is diopside.